Dire Team Band.
What's up, guys, and welcome back to MPGL8, second series of the day. We got Extremist going up against Execration in a two-game set. We'll see who's able to take the most points. I'm Mike Loris. Going to be joined by Danny on the mic. Got Corrupt Drop Bear this time, providing all them tasty stats. What are your thoughts on these two teams, Danny?
Okay, so it's been a pretty long time since I've seen Execration perform as a team. In terms of Extremists, now a lot of people are not going to remember them, but I in particular do. Now, the reason why I remember this team is that they were one of the teams from Southeast Asia that qualified from the Open SEA Shanghai Qualifier Major Qualifiers into the Standard Qualifier. Now, unfortunately, they did go, I think it was 0-4. Let me take a look here. Yeah, so they were in Group A. They went 0-4 to every single team in their group, but it was First Departure, it was Taring, it was Mineski, it was TNC. That are pretty difficult groups, but it says a lot for a no-name team to actually make it into the Shanghai Major main qualifiers. So up against Execration, which, looking at Execration's history, they went 0-4 as well. Mm-hmm. So they could be on the same level in terms of skill. But I could be wrong.
I would say Execration slightly better. Like, very frequently we see TNC and Execration kind of float to the top of these type of tournaments just because they are just a little bit better than everyone else. Extremists can definitely give them a run for their money. I'm pretty sure it's not going to be a 2-0 for Extremist, but I could very easily see a 1-1 as opposed to last series where, like, pretty confidently going to be 2-0 for TNC. But there's something about Execration's lineup that is kind of making me feel iffy about them. That big L for the captain. Kind of don't want to see that win, you know?
Absolutely. Right. So I suppose we're going to hop into the draft here. Now remember, this is Filipino Dota. Anything can happen. And I hear a lot of casters say it. Like, the Filipino scene in SEA is like the CIS region to Europe. Mm-hmm. So you could see some crazy stuff, but it's going to be most more or less standard stuff here for both squads. Is Ventral Spirit first pick up the Execration, whereas Extremists, they pick up the Enchantress and Doom. Two heroes that can make efficient use of the jungle.
And, well, Doom does a pretty good job against Enchantress as well, so they're protecting the Enchantress a little bit more by grabbing this combination. Doom as an early pick is going to make Execration think a little bit harder about their future picks. Don't really want to grab anyone who's super ultimate reliant. Didn't really see it a ton in the last game, but usually heroes like Tidehunter at this point are almost completely off the table for the Execration side. A quick look at the bans. We got the Roamers, the very frequently Roamers of the Earth Spirit Bounty Hunter, going to be taken out. Beastmaster and Io. Kind of weird to see those two heroes in the ban slot, although Beastmaster perfectly justifiable. Nowadays, Io not seeing nearly as much play, although it does largely vary from team to team. Some teams will first pick him without second thought. Other teams will never pick him ever. So it is kind of weird to see that, but of course that means Invoker is going to get into the pool. So Ventral Spirit, Invoker, pretty clean 1-2 punch. Got a little bit of minus armor here, but more importantly, they have Magic Missile and Sunstrike. Dealing with an Enchantress, those two tools are going to be quite nice assets for the Execration side.
So no one at the moment you could say is really showing their hand as to what they're going to be looking for. I guess if you look at Execration, they do seem to be running a more or less aggressive heroes. Like Ventral Spirit and Invoker can make a lot of things happen during the early game, but they can also fall back into a defensive mindset. You've got a defensive Ventral Spirit swap. You've got the Invoker that can go crosswex for setup. So even though they've got these strong heroes, they can definitely just sort of slow the game down a bit to fit them. It depends on what they decide to pick up for their carries. Now, it's a bit early to say what they could be going for, but the bans that we're seeing at net right now, they're getting rid of teamfight control from Extremists. Is there a reason as to why you'd be seeing the Face of Void ban? Maybe we could be seeing another strong offlane ban, such as the, oh man, I forgot the name of the offlaner now. Oh god, I need a brain fart.
Oh no.
Take over, Mike.
Fired. Fired. It's kind of weird to see this Faceless Void ban, honestly. Like, it would not really work out well for Extremis' lanes. Like, I guess you can have Enchantress and, like, Doom in the safe lane or something like that, but odds are one of these two heroes is going to go offlane. And for Execration, they could have easily gotten Faceless Void into, I mean, not a Witch Doctor anymore, but something along those lines, and would have been a pretty large threat and a pretty good countermeasure to someone like an Enchantress. You could just blow her up without any sort of response. Is vulnerable to a Doom in that regard, though, so maybe they're going to play around that slightly, but a lot of offlane hate, a little bit off on hate from the Execration side, which is, in my opinion, not justified. Whereas for Extremist, it is. You get rid of the Broodmother, get rid of the Batrider. Execration still need their offlane hero, and with Tidehunter effectively banned out, looks like Extremist are in a pretty good spot. Execration, though, going with the Ursa afterwards, on the Dire side, no less. So going into Roshan, going to be an absolute cakewalk for the Execration team. Extremists don't really have any great way of answering an early Rosh to Execration. Early game fighting, not super strong for Extremists, and they don't really have any free way of getting vision. I guess Enchantress can throw a creep in, but that's about it.
But the good thing, though, is that their lanes are looking pretty solid. The PL pickup on Extremists, this is a huge indicator that it's going to be the PL Invoker mid matchup, which for Execration to not ban the PL, a lot of people have seen the strength of PL. You have to respect that hero now. You just can't let him do whatever he wants. He's a mid hero that can pressure the Invoker and also scales if he can't get that farm. So for Execration to give such a strong hero away, they've got to have a plan with their draft. Like the Ursa, I'm not a big fan of Ursa yet. Maybe just because I haven't really been hit with the Ursa waves as of yet. Ursa does not deal with the PL relatively well. He doesn't really have any sort of AoE to clear the illusions. Doom, he can Doom the Ursa. And even though Ursa is pretty tanky, that's not really going to be enough to warrant him to go back into the fight whilst doomed. And the Phoenix pickup for Execration, I'm not really seeing the synergy here for their draft. Can you actually pick something apart here?
As far as working together, the heroes on Execration don't really do it the best. But as far as going up against the Extremist heroes, that's where the Ursa is going to come into play. Just a lot of quick damage to deal with the Enchantress, mostly. Just, you know, Untouchable is irrelevant when you're up against Ursa. And she doesn't exactly have a lot of health. On top of that, Phoenix is a pretty good answer to kind of like a supporty, greedy answer to the likes of Doom. Makes Phantom Lancer's life a little bit more difficult. He really doesn't want to be hitting an egg. You can't proc illusions off that, I don't believe, so that's a knob he wants to do, and he kind of has to. Extremists don't really have any great heroes of doing that either. It's a very Chinese opening for the draft, from the Execration side, and I don't think they are really going to get punished by this. That's really the issue with Phoenix, is can you get away with a Phoenix? And if the answer is yes, I mean, go ahead and get him. He's such a powerful support hero if he's not punished early on. It doesn't seem like that's just going to grab a Lycan for their last pick. Their pushing power is not nothing, but I don't really see where the Lycan fits into this particular draft. Execration took out the Weaver, knowing that they don't really have a ton of CC. Someone like a Morphling could have done really well for the Extremist side, play a little bit more of a late game angle, but Lycan is a little bit more of a early mid game based carry. He's usually picked up to destroy towers, and for Extremist, I don't really know if that's the best game plan.
If you take a look at their draft before the Lycan, they didn't have the best tower push. Enchantress is reasonable with the creeps. Doom doesn't really, he's not really able to push that much. Same with the Witch Doctor, and PL, to a certain degree, he can push. So like the Lycan does add that pushing potential on Extremis. So if they win a team fight, they can go straight, take down a tower nice and easily, nice influx of gold. I can't help but feel that Lycan, he is actually going to be great this game. There are not many disables to keep the Lycan in place. Normally, one way to deal with the Lycan is to burst him from 100 to 0. And one of their main stunts for no Execration is going to be the Venge and, to a certain degree, Tusk. You can't even rely on the Snowball because the Lycan moves so quickly as well. I can't help but feel like Siki could really get away with playing the Lycan, assuming he doesn't get punished super early on, which we all know that that the Lycan can be heavily punished during the laning phase. He just has no sustain, doesn't have the best HP pool, no real defensive mechanisms. So for Execration, expect them to pressure that Lycan before that he hits 6.
The offlane for Execration, the lane where Lycan is most likely going to go, is not incredibly strong. Like, what's the best situation here? Like, I guess Tusk Ursa would be, in theory, the best to deal with that Lycan, but that's a pretty deep commitment. I'm kind of stuck on Phoenix's support here, although I guess it's very possible they switch out how he's going to be played, play him a little more of an offlane, which is kind of mediocre to say the least, but Execration's early game laning answers to the Lycan are few and far between, even though that's kind of, as you alluded to, what they have to be doing in order to deal with that hero. So Extremists, even though this Lycan in their own draft is kind of awkwardly positioned, there's just another great hero that's great up against what Execration have. So for the Extremist side, not really sure what their draft is honestly meant to do, but the heroes that they do have are decently positioned up against what Execration have. The Enchantress perhaps in the worst situation going up against this Ursa, but everyone else, like the Phantom Lancer, the Doom, they're in a pretty good spot compared to what Execration are bringing to the table.
So for now, just gotta wait for this dastardly pause to go away. And I guess we should just do team introductions. It's gonna be a little bit quiet here. So I'll start off with Extremists, as I have seen them in the past. Blast from the past. Gonna be starting with our Doom. His name is QZ. Gonna be heading into the offlane. Mad on the Enchantress that's still in the fountain. God, our PL going up against the Invoker in the mid lane. Sikki on the Lycan that's gonna be going safe lane. And finally, we have Oheb, our Witch Doctor, going on a small warding mission with that Phoenix Observer ward.
Alright, so Execration, they're gonna put Tims on the Phoenix, going down to the first. Kimmo's on the Venge. Got Abed. Cool, on the Invoker. Nando is on the Ursa, and R is going real deep as the Tusk boots first. Is this just the pure roaming Tusk game? Tusk can very easily roam in with the Vengeful Spirit if he has Snowball. So level 2 is really at a premium here for the Tusk, and ganking in Ursa's lane or Invoker's lane is going to be a cakewalk. But this, of course, is going to put the Phoenix down on this bottom lane, and this is a hero that's going to have to play pretty scared more often than not. The upside is pretty high if you're going to be able to get a high level Phoenix, then the hero is just nuts out of control. But he's gonna not even really be happy trading hits with the likes of Witch Doctor, because there's gonna be Howl in play as well. So Phoenix's offlane time is going to be difficult, and I don't see Tusk Vengeful Spirit really being able to help out that much.
I guess the only saving grace here for the Phoenix is it's very difficult for Extremists to even set a gank up on the hero. Their only main initiating stun is the Witch Doctor cask, which it's a projectile. The Phoenix can dive before it lands, assuming he's got the right angle as well. So, like, I guess that's the good news of Phoenix. He won't die, but it just won't guarantee him that EXP that he so desperately needs. We did see the Tusk actually sitting where the Ancient camp was on the Radiant side. It looked like he was hoping to at least get into position to jump onto the PL. But he's moved elsewhere with the Venge. They're going to go up top this time. They do have a smoke on Kimmo. I don't think they're going to be using it this early. They're just going to walk into the Doom for now and just push him out of that lane. Don't really want to be getting him too much of that EXP. And actually has been blocked off now. Has to go for the Scorched Earth. Completely jukes the strike and is still running. Can he actually get out of here? Is there any more disables left? There's nothing left in the tank. He just walks free.
Scorched Earth, level 1, still gives you as much movement speed as any other level of Scorched Earth, so just enough to run out of there. He is, however, now not going to have it, was forced to level it up. That means he does not have Devour, and even if he did, this camp is not going to spawn. So poor Doom is actually going to have a chance at dewarding it if he's going to dig his way in properly, but he really doesn't want to spend tangos to do so. This is really where you want to see Tusk at level 2. Having Snowball is such a huge difference between having it and not having it. Now Abed and over in mid lane in a lot of trouble. Lance was already thrown out. Ice Wall is going to be invoked. However, he's still going to get, I believe, hit with the clap. Oh, it might have been just out of range. Invoker, either way, getting a very early Ice Wall is going to keep him safe. And it is a concern for this Invoker. Rotations in from the Enchantress. But even in between that, Invoker's matchup versus a Phantom Lancer with Poor Man Shield, Fairy Fire is not that good, at least until the Tusk and Vengeful Spirit come in, but even then, the Tusk is not the type of crowd control you want up against Phantom Lancer's Doppelganger.
Not even just crowd control, like he doesn't even have the sufficient AoE to really clear the PL illusions too. So there is actually a very good chance of the PL potentially turning on either of these heroes and going for a kill. Because I guess the sad truth here is that PL is a very resilient hero. He has relatively decent in agility game, and he's sitting on a decent 5 armor to begin with, plus the Poor Man Shield as well to mitigate some of the incoming damage. Also, it can be super elusive with the Doppelganger. I don't know if they're going to be able to deal with H-God, as you mentioned, like, also the added bonus of everything that you spoke about too. Just, I think they're just going to have to either really focus down the PL or just leave him and try and go find kills elsewhere. It's just not going to be as valuable, however.
Top lane is difficult to kill. The only reason they got that damage off in the Doom last time was because of this Observer Ward. Didn't see them coming because Doom was so far off to the right. And now it's going to keep him almost completely safe. Bottom lane, a lane where Phoenix is actually getting quite a bit. In fact, a lot more than I expected. He's level 4 already, and he's actually ahead of the Lycan. He's forced to split a little bit of experience there with the Witch Doctor, but Phoenix, for right now, isn't really going to be a huge asset. It's going to really come in a couple more minutes, so Execration with this opening of Boots First, Tusk, Ventral Spirit. Unable to get any ganks going is pretty darn problematic. These heroes really don't scale that well, especially together, when they're not doing a lot aggressively. So that's really going to be a problem. Tim's in the bottom lane. Going to get caught with a couple of wolves. Still is going to be fine, but Execration, they know that they can't really easily gank this Lancer, and they're going to actually miss the Sentry Ward on this Observer, so this Doom is still keeping himself safe. Granted, not getting a ton of farm, but he has Devour. He can work around that later.
Oh, gosh. This is such a big problem for the offlane. I guess, like, the good news, as he said, is that the Doom is getting a couple of levels, but he's not able to get the Devour off, which would be ideal if you're that Doom. Just at least eating a creep, getting that extra bonus gold, everything helps in and off with the offlane Doom. He's still sitting on 2, almost hit 3. If you do the comparison, though, like, Tim's on the Phoenix has a huge, huge good time up down here. Oh, Jesus.
They cancel the rush, but they still land a stomp. There is no True Sight here. They still force out 200 mana from the Invoker. Now RR is going to come in. I don't think he could actually do anything here, so he's probably just going to leave. But, yeah, forcing out a lot of mana of the Invoker is not nothing, but H-God unfortunately canceled his Phantom Rush and has a double damage rune, so maybe even could have put a little bit more damage into the Invoker. Another failed gank from this Enchantress. She is level 3, though, so she's still getting experience in between these ganks, and still the Phantom Lancer is leading CS over the Invoker. Not by a huge margin, but it is there. QZ getting into a fight with Nando right now. He's going to pop the Scorched Earth rather late. Ursa's damage is way too high. Nando's going to get a pretty free kill up towards top lane as Doom kind of walks right into it.
Very good for Ursa as well. If you can get Nando to snowball on this Ursa, this hero can be very, very explosive. And that is something that you don't want to see Nando explode on this Ursa, because if he actually gets an early blink, there is not that much counterplay that extremists have to really avoid getting killed off by Nando. He just jumps on top of you, goes for an Earth Shock, a couple of overpower shots, and that's going to be it. Even Enchantress, you mentioned this during the laning phase, very vulnerable to getting jumped on by this Ursa. So if Execration can, if they can pull this Ursa through during the laning phase and really amp up his farm with some creeps as well as some stacks, even a couple of heroes here and there, that could be a really good spot for Execration to take the reins of this game and just keep on going. They're going to try and fight up against the Doom. Stun is there. They're going to commit Sunstrike as well. Doesn't even kill him. They're completely whiffed. And the Doom kills off the Ursa in the end. And Enchantress is sending creeps in. And Chemo dies to QZ. Or the Enchantress anyway, but that backfired so badly for Execration. Oh, jeez.
Sunstrike, man. Sunstrike was split between, like, a million creeps there, so it did, like, 10 damage or something pathetic like that.
Gosh.
So that was inherently an aggressive play there from Execration. Maybe made just that play at the wrong timing. Again, if there's no creep wave there, you get the kill pretty easily, but seeing as though you're trying to go for a Doom with Scorched Earth, you have to burst them down, and the longer you chase, the less likely you're going to get that kill. So Execration going to get punished as they lose the Ursa, a huge hero that they really can't afford to be losing. They're going to snowball in down towards the bottom lane, though. Lycan is going to get the shapeshift off beforehand. Sunstrike is going to actually miss this time. Lycan's going to run to the north. Supernova damage, it's not going to be enough. 3 HP! Oh my god, Lycan Balance Hero, he is free and clear. They already used the Sunstrike, and now Abed's in a little bit of trouble himself. Boulder Toss is going to be there. This time, they have the Dust. He's going to Wex up and try to book it. Lance is going to kill him, though. That'll be a kill for the extremist side. Tim's going to teleport in with the Fire Spirits at the ready, so has 2 more left to fire. He's going to pick a fight with the Enchantress. Icarus dive around, now hit with the Magic Missiles, the Enchantress. Right click to follow, and it won't be enough, actually, as H-God's going to get right on top of this Phoenix. They'll kill out the Enchantress, but grab the Phoenix in exchange. Double kill for the Lancer, as H-God is getting a little bit too much now. They're on the run, Execration. There is no more mana left for the Phantom Lancer, so they should call it quits. But it's going to be the Ursa to... Whoa, did Ursa just get solo killed? He did. So Ursa got killed up towards top. Extremists grabbed 2 kills over in mid, only losing their Ench. That's a huge win for Extremists.
I don't know what happened to Extremists. It's like they just took the reins of the game and said, okay, we are going to start taking over from here on out. They get a couple of nice kills early on, but everything just seems to be going right for the Extremists, whereas it's the complete opposite for Execration. Everything that they do, is backfiring left, right, center. Every play that they're making has not been successful. And if it keeps going on like this, if you compare the two drafts, Extremists, if they get ahead, it is going to be a very long road for Execration to make it back into this game comfortably on equal footing with Extremists. I pointed this out during the laning phase, during the draft. With Extremists' draft, if they grab kills, they can push for objectives. If Execration go for kills, they can try and take objectives, but their heroes just don't push towers fast enough. If the fights happen in, for example, in their jungle, and the creep wave is not pushed, there is going to be no tower for Execration, whereas for Extremists, they can make up for it with their raw power in terms of tower push.
There's also something to be said about the fact that Lancer, the mid laner, has the most net worth in the game right now. 2 kills, lots of CS. Typically, in an average mid lane Phantom Lancer game where he's not, you know, getting all these kills, he's going to be really powerful while his Lance is maxed out, but then, you know, in between like the 15 and 25 minute mark, he takes a little bit of a dip in power because his right click isn't necessarily enough to keep him relevant, whereas everyone else is going to be scaling. They're going to go for QZ up towards top lane. Magic Missile is going to be there. Scorched Earth is used first. Sunstrike this time will land perfectly, and Doom will be torn to shreds. TP's coming in a little bit too late. Doom will fall. But because the Phantom Lancer is so far ahead, he can afford to get the travels and very quickly move on to his next item and really mitigate that weakness, that downtime where Phantom Lancers usually experience a period where they just can't get any more kills because they're just not overtly strong enough. That may or may not be an issue here for H-God because he is so far ahead, but up towards top lane, Ursa has taken the net worth lead, has quite a bit of damage working for him, and he's going to put that damage, first of all, to use onto this top lane T1. With Kimmo here and RR, it's going to be risky for any one hero to defend this. Speaking of, Witch Doctor's going to try. Bad idea. They get the Doom onto Nando, taking tower shots well. Siki's going to rotate in with the shapeshift at the ready. He's going to pop some wolves. Magic Missile from Kimmo. There's not enough mana, actually. Now Nando is in a lot of trouble. Doom maybe denied? No, he's dead. And Doom will also actually grab two of them with Scorched Earth. Now they're on to RR. TP coming in from Tims. He's going to go Supernova. Siki, does he have enough damage to kill it? No, he doesn't. Not enough attack speed, especially with the shapeshift running out. He will back off before the stun's gonna land, but rotation is coming in from the extremist side. Tim's gonna use his Icarus dive for damage. Not a good idea. Infernal Blade not actually gonna connect, but they land the net with the Enchantress, and now Tim's is gonna get Phantom Rush down. He'll get torn apart. Sunstrike is gonna completely miss. The Enchantress therefore is gonna live as the final hero from Execration was able to teleport out of there, but extremist bringing everyone to this top lane and getting a pretty nice win even after a questionable Witch Doctor initiation.
That they almost killed off Mad with the Phoenix, actually, with the Fire Spirits. If he did not get that one tick of healing before the damage proc, I actually think Mad would have died there. But still, another successful run for Extremists. More kills, and the fight's even happening right next to the tower with creeps. That's so ideal. They took the tower so quickly. And that was supposed to be Execration pushing, right? Like, Execration was pushing top lane. The tower's only down to half. And that's just the nature of their draft. Their heroes just don't push effectively. So, like, for Extremists, this is essentially smooth sailing. If they just keep playing like this, if everything keeps going according to plan, then it's going to be pretty handy-dandy okay. Whereas for Execration, I have Aegis on the Ursa, which, you know, it's fine, but that does not completely patch this giant hole in Execration's draft. They don't really have a tempo controller because I bet on the Invoker is trying to recover. And they're running a Phoenix, which the hero just doesn't tempo control, period, without his team. Mm-hmm.
It's kind of more of an investment late game, this Phoenix pick. Like, we can see already how much damage he's actually able to do. Sunray is going to be leveled up next, and that's going to be even more damage, not to mention the heal. So there's a lot of power in this Phoenix, but not right now. Usually it's going to be just the Ursa to do it all. And with the Tusk, if they were able to cleanly get kills in the Doom without dying, then yeah, they would be feeling pretty good. But because they've pretty much died, lost a hero every single time they've gone for that, not as far ahead as they would really like to be. Invoker as well having a really tough time, and now we're going to have a smoke up from the extremist side. Seems like a couple of these creeps didn't necessarily get the memo, but still, they will find an angle perhaps to go for Nando. He has a blink and an Aegis, and he will see everyone coming get out of there. So extremist will fail this gank, but H-God now has 12-minute travels. Very fast net worth, as you can see from that stat. So now the race is on for Phantom Lancer to get his next item, whether that's Diffusal Blade or Yasha or Drums or something like that. This downtime right after travels, where Phantom Lancer is at his weakest, and Extremists, therefore, are also at their weakest. And We'll see if Execration can actually punish it. Nando's in a perfect spot to do so. I don't think they saw that tree go down, although they will kind of check it out. Nando's not going to be spotted. They will scout around with the wolves, see Tim's. Still, the fire spirits are being chucked out. Not a ton of damage there. Double boulder toss. Lots of damage to the Phoenix, rather. Nando's going to jump in right into Mad, but gets stunned up midway and will fail to get the kill. And now Siki is going to chase forward for RR, will tear the Tusk apart. Death Ward and Doom onto Nando will take out the Aegis, and they'll pop the Supernova before it can explode. Siki's still shapeshifted. He'll get Sunstruck. No! He's actually going to run right out of it, and he will dodge it completely. Nando's going to drop very low to the double damage Aegis God, and they're going to be able to grab the Aegis and the kill. Siki is still alive with Mad as well. With level 3 Voodoo Restoration, they're going to look to heal up and continue this push. It's a massacre in favor of Extremists. They lose absolutely nothing. They gain the tower. They gain 3 kills. Maybe they're going to lose a top lane T1, but that's a small price to pay for such a massive victory, especially when they can go for a little bit more. Shards will fly, not do a whole lot. Tower's in a little bit of trouble. There's no way that Eventual Spirit and Tusk can hold this. They can hold it with a Phoenix if Phoenix was here right now, but he's obviously not. This Howl damage is way too much, and they'll take down a Tier 2 as well.
I don't even think they would have been able to hold it with Tim's either. Without the Supernova, there's no backup insurance that the Phoenix could potentially come back and also do that extra damage. So, but Execration, every single fight is just going absolutely terribly for Extremists. They're finding so many amazing opportunities, making the most of their draft. They're also farming while they're at it too. And also that stat on the PL, like, that just goes to show how much farm is on H-God. He is... You can say he's M-God because he's got so much money, or G-God if you really want to. But geez, Execration, they're in a very deep hole. And unfortunately, no one's really given them shovels, they just decided to give them spoons. I'm not too sure if they're going to be able to dig out of it anytime soon. The normal situation is smokes, right? People always say, if you're in trouble, go for smokes, pick heroes off. But look at the positioning of Extremists. They're always clumped up together just so that they don't get caught out. They're playing so perfectly.
Next creation, their late game isn't quite ready yet. They even got the Roshan and the Ursa, and usually we see these type of situations happen when Ursa's not able to get Rosh, and up against Extremis' draft, that was possible. They could have easily taken Roshan before the Ursa, but they even got that asset, but they handled it so well. They're gonna jump in towards the Witch Doctor. Walrus Punch, Magic Missile, not quite gonna do it. Supernova's right in the middle of the fight, however, that might not be a good thing. Supernova will crack, and now the floodgates are open. They're gonna kill off the Vengeful Spirit, run through the rock to kill off the Tusk, triple kill for Siki. He's looking for 4, they're gonna net down Abed, that's not cool, and the Invoker will not give a 4 kill to the Lycan. It seems like QZ wants a little bit of dough from that, but still, it's a massacre in favor of Extremists yet again. This time the Ursa, not the hero to be really relevant in that fight. At least he didn't die, but man, Execration did not stand a chance there. They just charged in Extremists and there's nothing to stop them. Witch Doctor's very happy to take the bullet if it means the team is able to get that much going. Now the tier 2 is going to drop over in mid lane. Top tier 2 also potentially in trouble, and we only have a 4-minute period of downtime where H-God is... quote unquote, at his weakest. Now he has Diffusal Blade on top of the Boots of Travels. This Phantom Lancer is really fat, and his farm is actually going to be put to really good work, as opposed to the Invoker, whose farm is kind of just artificially inflating his potential in this game.
Blink Dagger picked up on the Doom as well. God, there's so many items being picked up by Extremists. And if you're Execration, I'm not a big fan of Offlane Phoenix, and this is one of the glaring reasons as to why he is... He's not very popular in most circumstances. The hero suffers very, very badly if his team is not in a position where they can draw attention away from the Supernova Egg. Phoenix does do a lot of damage over time with the Fire Spirits, and also if he can get some long duration sun rays off, they can also be doing quite a bit of damage too. But because no one in Execration can draw attention away from the Supernova Egg, he's never going to have a chance to come back in and reapply Fire Spirits, reapply Icarus Dive, reapply Sunray. Yeah, you're missing out on so much damage potential on Tim's on this Phoenix just because they can't protect the Supernova Egg. But then you also have to ask, like, how do they protect it then? Like, you can't. You don't have heroes that are able to buy time. There's no Chronosphere. There's no Roar. They've got a Snowball, but that's not really enough. And unfortunately, Abed can sort of fulfill this role if he went Quas Wex. But then they would have been missing out on a whole ton of damage. They need the damage, but they also need the setups. But he can't go for both builds.
Tornado is the only thing that they really have that can do that. And as you said, it's a level 1 Wex Tornado. It's not exactly something to write home about. We've seen a lot of support Phoenix play, and that's because you can max out the Sunrise, still have a really large impact, and not be punished. I mean, I was talking about that during the draft. The difference in this game between a support-based Phoenix and an offlane-based Phoenix would have been very, very minimal. Up on top lane, they pretty much didn't need all the heroes there. They just needed Magic Missile and Ursa to kill off that Doom, so you could have had a very greedy jungler, as per normal in this metagame. Usually you have your babysitting support, like an Oracle, and then your greedy support, like a Bounty Hunter or an Earth Spirit, and Phoenix in that greedy support role is, I feel, just so much stronger. You will sacrifice a little bit of damage in the Fire Spirits. Usually those aren't leveled up as much, but you pretty much get to the same spot at around the same timing, so it is kind of a shame to see Execration now with not really much counterplay up against the Extremist Draft. They still have a Tier 2 Outer Tower, but that's about it. Extremists, they're looking at a level 3 Necrobook very soon, and even if they don't want to make a play off of that, they can still play a little bit of a slower farming game. Phantom Lancer is way in the lead in that regard, and Lycan, being so far ahead this early on, can also be a very effective late-game hero.
So Extremists, they're sort of slowing it down a little bit. They're retreating back to farming up their next big items. When do you think is the go call for Extremists? Are they possibly just waiting for this Necro 3 to be finished up on the Lycan before they make their move? Are they waiting for BKBs? Or is it just that Roche respawn that they're looking for?
Probably just the Roche respawn. They know that Execration are going to want to fight over that, so Extremists can probably take the fight in that area and, you know, call that a win and be fine. Like, they have the Blink Dagger already on the Doom. Any additional item they're going to get, aside from that the final level of Necrobook, which is coming out right now, is going to take quite a long time. Like, Enchantress is not very close to that Aghanim Scepter, so this is... Oh, it's not coming out right now, is it? It is. It should be. Right now, it's going to take a while until Extremists get another large spike in power. Waiting for BKBs would be nice, but it's going to give Execration a lot of time to make some sort of play. And I think it's probably not worth the wait, honestly. They could very easily clear Roshan, and it's only going to be spawning another minute, and we could already see the dogs start to scout that out.
Yeah, definitely tells that Extremists want to claim the Aegis for themselves. Is there any detection for Execration? I guess the sad thing is they don't even have any heroes that have Helm of the Dominators to leave the creeps in. I guess the Invoker can leave his Forge Spirits in, but he's not really sending them over. He's just waiting for it to cool down, and he's farming the jungle with them.
They'll have a Sigil, they'll have a Wave. It's not nothing. And Ursa can clear it out really quickly, but if Ursa goes into that Roshan pit, and if Extremists have Vision on it, then they're just going to turn on Howl and shove the top lane down in the blink of an eye. And in fact, H-God's already working at that. Forge Spirits will pull off the aggro, a little bit at least, but still, with the Enchantress creep here, they'll beat it down. H-God has more than enough damage to do so, and trades across the map for Execration. They'll get a little bit of farm on the Ursa, I suppose, clear a couple of jungle stacks. Again, nothing to write home about. They lose a tower with no response. Oh, this is not looking good for the Execration side. They're looking at Siki over in mid, but this is a big Lycan we're talking. Just an Invoker with no setup on himself, no Yule Scepter or anything like that, so... It will be Nando now going into the Roche pit. Everyone from Extremists is going to teleport in towards mid. Are they going to smoke up and go? They will. However, I think it's too late. Nando just does this so quickly, so they will have to deal with a double life Ursa, but they dealt with it so well last time that maybe they'll be able to do it again. Oh, Van Lancer is going to travel onto a Wolf. They get the Doom onto the Invoker. Ursa does grab the Aegis, and now he's going to straight TP out of there. However, Abed and Kimmo are not going to be as lucky. They'll lose the Invoker, they'll lose the Ventral Spirit, and get away with the Aegis. But man, Extremist teleporting onto the Wolf, that is a play that I did not expect, and I'm pretty sure Execration didn't expect it either. The Roshan is super expensive for them.
So, Aegis claimed on the Roshan, it's nice. You're gonna be denying it from Extremist, I think, which is the biggest thing. Mm-hmm. So without the Aegis now, do Extremists just sort of sit back more into this passive style that they've been playing for the past 5 minutes? Or do you think they're going to amp up the aggression at some point to not only take the Aegis away, but at least apply some pressure going high ground? Because there actually isn't that much going up high ground. If you think about it, looking at Execration's draft, there's no massive spells like Ravage, there's no Winter's Curse, there's no Wall. I think the biggest spell you'd be looking at is the Supernova. But even then, there's a lot of gap closer on Extremists to kill that off quite easily.
And the Sunray is something that Doom can very easily just blink in Infernal Blade to cancel, or blink in Net. He actually has that creep digesting right now. So, yeah, they do have options. I like the high ground play. even going into this double life Ursa, like, they have the Phantom Lancer, so they could just kite the Ursa all day long. The Lycan, just that max movement speed is very difficult for the Ursa to get his claws into. Not the Invoker is back up. That play is going to have to be set up first by a smoke, but Extremists, again, if they sit back a little bit too far, sit back a little bit too long in this game and don't make any sort of significant plays, then Phoenix's at least later game impact is going to be a little bit more deadly. Invoker obviously going to be farming up, as will the Ursa. So Extremists, they probably will still have an edge by doing this, but they're putting themselves at more risk to something like this. Just the Tusk and the Vengeful Spirit roaming around. Not exactly the most deadly duo at this stage in the game, but still, if anyone on Extremists gets picked off, then that's going to completely stop any of their aggressive plans. They will have a Manta style up soon on H-God, and that is an item worth waiting for.
I think one thing that, if you're Extremists, that should be picking up shortly is a gem. They need to take some of this ward vision away from Execration. There are so many wards on the map giving Execration vision of some of the Extremist heroes that they're feeling more confident moving around the map. If you can take that away, you're going to sort of force them to be in a more defensive position just because they don't know where the heroes are coming, and obviously it's going to be able to allow Extremists to pick off some of those extra kills. But for now, it just looks like Gem isn't really in the minds of Extremists now. The supports may be saving for it. Witch Doctor's dead poor. Enchantress wants Ag, so you don't even expect the Enchantress to buy it. And Doom obviously wanting to buy Doom things, so it looks like Gem's just not on the board here for Extremists. It would be a good item to consider, though.
I mean, you get rid of the map control of an Execration, you can set up for maybe a pick-off into a high ground scenario, and also you can see the enemy Tusk and Invoker when they decide to go invis for whatever reason. So yeah, there's a lot of value to be had here from Extremist Gem. I suppose they have Necronomicon 3 to kind of get around some of those issues, specifically versus those heroes. You're not going to really sweep the map with your Necro books, but either way, it looks like Smoke round 2 is coming up for the Extremist side. It will be. The Phantom Lancer has the Travels at the ready, has Manta style on the Courier. Do they know where the Execration side are, though? It doesn't seem like they do. They may have just had a ward killed off in the Dire Jungle, maybe, but either way, Phantom Lancer is shoving the bottom lane all the while and can very easily rotate back in just by teleporting in on a Wolf or an Ekro unit or something like that. So seems like this sweep is not going to do anything for the Extremist side, but I mean, they're getting so much farm on this Lancer, but as dangerous as that is, we're also seeing Ursa and Invoker kind of keep up. In fact, remarkably so. The fact that they're keeping up is quite impressive.
I'm really impressed that Abed's managed to catch up, considering the lane he had in that mid lane. But now, here we go. High ground attempt from Extremist. Aegis is still available on Nando, and he does have a 10-second BKB. How good is this defense going to be?
Tim's is going to lose all his mana, first of all, so that's not quite nice. They're going to blink in. Doom RR, that's not the right target. Nando, in the meantime, though, is at the same time going to lose all of his mana, has a BKB, but he really doesn't want to use it right now. Swap axe and keep RR safe, but H-God's going to dive right in with another double damage rune. How does this guy keep finding it? He will grab the kill onto the Tusk, but that is Doom used. They will take down the tower. Sikki had his eyes on the prize the entire time. Fortification will wear off. And with the Howl damage, with the Slyken damage, Raxus will die in the blink of an eye. Execration with no fight response here. We'll lose Raxus for free. H-God's going to get jumped, but Manta Style is going to split off that slow. And now jump in from the Doom. Icarus dive is there, plus a Supernova. The only hero in danger, though, is the Doom. And at this point, he's expendable. Ice Wall is going to be put up to slow down the Enchantress. Can they kill off either of these two supports? Yes, they will. With the Ursa turning on everything, he'll grab a triple kill. But they lose Raxus. They need to get more. Jump up to the high ground. H-God is going to try to teleport away. The damage is actually going to be not enough, but they will get the cold snap and cancel the TP and then kill him off. Ultra kill for Nando. The only problem is that it came just a little bit too late. The Raxus has already been taken.
Raxus get taken. It's a great objective to pick up as Extremists at the cost of a lot of gold into the pockets of Execration. I suppose, like, the good news, though, for Extremists is that Execration don't have the best heroes when it comes to creep clearing. So this creep wave on the bottom lane is going to be a huge pain in the backside when it comes to Execration having to deal with it all the time. They're going to try and go for a very heavy push in the mid lane, but a lot of Extremists have respawned. Do they contest to protect this T2? It looks like for now they're not really in a position to do so, as the Lycan's up top. He's got a TP available and the tower just drops too quickly. So kills plus a tower. That's a really good turn of events for Execration, but as you said, is it enough to bring them back into the fold? What are the items that they've picked up after this? Like, there's a whole ton of gold on Nando. What would you be looking for if you're the Ursa? Would you try and go for a disable such as a Scyther and Abyssal next?
Yeah, it's probably going to be one of those items. Like, but at the same time, if you're going to get initiated upon, you're just... And I don't know, maybe Lincoln Sphere is a little bit too defensive for him. I feel like Basher is probably the item here for the Ursa.
I said Lotus Orb, but then I was thinking, who's going to buy the Lotus Orb? Because they don't have an off... I suppose maybe Tim's could pick it up instead of buying the Shivas. Then at least you're going to have the Lotus Orb to work with.
Yeah, that would be... I mean, Lotus Orb is good. I'm not sure if it's better than Shivas, especially on this Phoenix. The Icarus Dive Shiva's Blast is pretty ridiculous, so... It's worth considering at the very least, but no, it's too late. Shiva's Guard already picked up, and I think that's probably the right move, but... I mean, any item that Extreme Execration get right now individually won't be enough. Invoker has another 3200 gold, something like a Sheepstick. Now that can be enough. That'll allow Execration to get the initiation off on their own terms, whereas previously it's been pretty much always Extremists getting the jump on someone with the Doom. But right now, they don't have any effective way outside of a Snowball. I guess a Blink Ursa to initiate. Blink Ursa isn't even that impressive since he doesn't have an Abyssal Blade. He's going to go for an Ultimate Orb item. So, you know, Lincoln Sphere, Eye of Scotty, Sheepstick, all good items on the Ursa. But I think the biggest problem here for Execration is that bottom lane fight started with Doom on the worst target, the Tusk, and it still got Extremist Thraxes. Like, that's not supposed to happen.
Alright, so it looks like for now, Extremists wanting to go for a push high ground. Now, I'm not too sure if they saw Tim's Shivas. I don't think so. This could be a bit of a surprise factor. But I'm not too sure if it's really going to be able to change much of the game. It's just Shivas at the end of the day. It's a nice little slow, it provides a little bit of extra damage, armor for the Phoenix. But it doesn't completely solve the problems for Execration. They need this hard lockdown, and as you said, Sheepstick on the Invoker is the go-to item next. It's just going to be a while before he's able to grab that. And lots of respect being shown by Extremists here. Even though they won the bottom fight, they are taking it nice and slow. They are still slowly applying pressure, but they're not really in a hurry to do so. They're just wanting to keep Execration cooped up in their base.
Combo QZ, 100-0 from the Invoker. Flyby Shiva's Guard is going to actually buy enough space to swap back the Witch Doctor, and he's going to get torn apart as well. Double kill for the Invoker. Immediate buyback on the Doom. That is aggressive. They're on the top lane. Sicky is going to try to battle up against Backdoor Protection. Unfortunately, that's not going to work out. So Execration, get a free set of picks. Get a buyback on top of it, which honestly should not be expended there from Extremists. And they don't use the supernova. Shiva's Guard, at this point, with no BKB yet on the Lycan, is actually really intimidating. Like, the minus attack speed aura is devastating, not to mention the damage and slow. So, Tim's is actually working with quite a lot of damage now. Late game Phoenix, it's legit until you get your BKBs up. And BKBs, at least not on the Phantom Lancer, anytime soon. Very soon on the Lycan, but Execration will avoid that push for a little bit. And maybe they can slide towards Roche right now. This is number 3, so it has Aegis and Cheese, and Ursa can, as we all know, do it pretty quickly.
Well, Ursa just picked up his Scythe of Ice, so this could be a really good smoke opportunity for Execration to go for a quick snipe and then to go on the Roche pit. If they can kill the Doom again, that's no buyback. That's a guaranteed fourth hero down and out for the count. So here we go. Smoke deployed. Mission, kill Extremists. Go. Can they find these heroes, though?
Well, just saying Ursa 100% win rate with Sheepstick, so Execration literally cannot lose from this point. That's how stats work. It's curious. Kim O is going to push up the high ground. He's going to run into the Lycan. Not exactly the hero that Venge wants to. They're going to Doom Tim's. That's a great target. Tornado, though, right in the choke point with a Meteor and a Sunstrike, is going to drop QZ super low before the fight really gets started. They will chase after the Ventral Spear, kill her off. Ice Wall goes up. Sicky does not care about that. RR is going to get torn apart in just a matter of seconds. Now they're going to chase after Tim's, who's finally going to get the Doom worn off. He's going to dive away, but the Infernal Blade is still going to kill him off. And now Roshan, he's going to drop Cheese on the deck. Nando's going to grab the Aegis, but it's Nando versus everybody, and he's gonna get netted down by QZ's Doom and still getting picked apart. He'll pop his ultimate, save himself a little bit of damage, but now the Aegis is gonna be expended. The Cheese was picked up, I believe, by someone on the Radiant side. I don't know where it went, but Abed's gonna jump right back in, trying to give Nando a little bit of cover. He'll be successful, but he'll probably lose his life. Oh, he's gonna go Ghost Walk. There's no True Sight here. They're gonna try to kill off the Supernova, but that's not gonna happen. It's going to erupt. Stun up a couple heroes, give the Phoenix another dive out. He bought back for this one. Phantom Lancer's right on his tail, however. He has more purge charges. Phoenix does not have an Icarus dive. He's going to get glimmered out, fly over the trees. H-God taking a lot of damage. Will doppelgang out, though, and dodge everything. And get back to his side of the map, at least a little bit closer to his allies. Nando has a sheep stick, but he can't quite find an angle here. They will cut him off with Tornado. That should not kill him. Not enough damage, I don't think. He's going to doppelgang again. Try to TP out. One more right-click, though, is going to get the kill. I don't know where the cheese actually ended up, but Execration take a really, really messy fight, but I think it could have been a lot worse.
It honestly could have been a lot worse. They are very lucky that they didn't lose anything else on top of that. Oh gosh. Now all of a sudden you have a whole bunch of Execration. They're slowly moving into the middle lane, but because there's no creep wave, they can't do anything with this. They're gonna have the Peel has buyback. There are heroes in the base ready to defend for extremists. Everything is almost available. You got the Doom coming up in 5. Witch Doctor Death Ward just came up, and when all that's said and done for Execration, they can't even push high ground or at least do some chip damage. They can't even find heroes. They could find the courier though if they can nicely spot this out, but it looks like he's found a nice little nook in the forest. So that little mini OD here gonna be able to keep the Shiva's Guard recipe in his pockets for that little bit longer. But we've had a couple of shaky fights now for extremists. They gotta be a little bit more careful, as some of these Execration heroes are starting to become pretty big threats.
Ursa on top of the net worth chart, Invoker right behind him, although, you know, almost Sikis bypassing that. It is still extremists with a lot of control over this game, assuming they have enough True Sight, and they do have the gem now on Mad. I think it's just his. I don't think it traded hands at all, so yeah, just Enchantress will have that answer to the Ghost Walk, will have the answer to the Glimmer Cape, which have been actually a lot more problematic than you would ordinarily expect given the stage in the game. Still, extremists, they are working with a Lycan, a hero that, even though he is so far ahead, may not have the impact specifically versus the heroes like Ursa and Invoker that you may want. Just has a lot to deal with, but still he has a fresh BKB, so even though Lycan as a hero is going to maybe not be in the best spot this stage in the game, his items are going to carry him through that BKB and cheese, no less. Plus an Eye of Skadi on Phantom Lancer. This guy is so difficult to bring down, as long as he's going to stay with his squad, which, you know, H-God may or may not want to do, but Execration, they're barely scraping out victories, kind of using buybacks to necessitate their wins. And now they have a cheese on the Phantom Lancer as well, so Execration will struggle, I think, to find more victories unless they get a Blink Sheepstick initiation from the Ursa. Anything less than that, I'm not worth it at this point, or not quite going to be good enough.
So it looks like they're going to be leaving the Peel behind, and the rest of extremists, they're looking for heroes. Unfortunately, the wolves don't spot anything out. They're going to be still heading into the jungle, but everyone down towards bottom for Execration. Execration's going to grab a free tower, Glyph deployed at least, but do extremists force them to TP back? They can reveal themselves in this top lane, and they can start pushing that top tower. If you compare the two teams, extremists will push. Extremists' push is vastly superior in every single way. They're waiting for someone to come on through, and they're gonna start TPing home. It looks like no one on the side of Execration wants to commit. Phoenix and Tusk, though. Oh, the Ursa. Oh, Nando. Oh, the hesitation from extremists. They did force the buyback, the BKB out, at least. That's gonna be no BKB on Nando now for the next fight.
Yeah, no H-God in the area immediately. They probably could have gotten a little bit more aggressive on an Ursa who just uses Blink Dagger. Get the Doom on him before the BKB pops up, and you can kill him easily afterwards. But still, this is a pretty good situation for the extremist side. Nando is going to have to get initiation off, but he will be doing it without any sort of safety precaution. Now the Doom's going to jump right in, Doom on a Tim's, and then walk right back. They know the Phoenix is out of the fight for quite a long time now, and that's going to be enough time to maybe take this set of Raxes, EMP, Meteor, Deafening Blast, doing a lot of damage to QZ, but not quite enough lethal damage to anyone. Now the cast going to bounce through onto everyone, just buying time for Sikki to right-click down these buildings, and Nando's caught in the middle of it. Ursa's going to try to turn and fight for his H-God, and he will actually win, but the Raxes once again have fallen. Supernova is going to go off, Sikki is stuck, and he will be brought down. Cold Snap Permastun for him. It's going to be Execration taking 4 kills, looking for that 5th one in the Enchantress. Tornado will fall short, and the Enchantress should sproink away, but the melee Raxes have been taken. But I mean, these fights are getting more and more expensive for the extremist side, if we could even call them fights. They were just kind of distracting away from that push. But that fight, I think we could call that a pretty clear victory for Execration.
They lost the Rax, though. Would you really say it's a victory? I would only say it's a victory if they're able to get their own objective out of this. Because by the time Execration push out this middle creep wave, you're going to have a lot of the extremist heroes either close to respawning or already back up. And it looks like for now, they're trying to make the most of this opening. The super creeps, they're slowly making their way through. It's not, the super creeps aren't quite at the creep wave yet. They are still just moving out slowly. So for Execration, they've got a timing window here before these extremist heroes come on through. I think the biggest thing to note is if you take a look at buyback status, there is only buyback available on the Enchantress. So this could be a turnaround for Execration if they punish some of these extremist heroes in their base right now. Although PL is very close to buyback.
I mean, the pushing situation is going to be a little bit awkward here for Execration. They have to tend to the bottom lane. Tims is going to go ahead and teleport back. But I think the big takeaway there was that Ursa, even after expending the BKB in a really bad situation there, even after that, it's still going to be almost a complete wipe in favor of Execration. Even after that really poor start of that fight, like, Extremists, they tried to have the Phantom Lancer man fight the Ursa, which, you know, isn't going to happen all the time, but Ursa's clearly going to come ahead in that way as well. So just how Execration took that fight really is going to make Extremists perhaps a little more cautious at actually making that push play. If they do try to race for objectives, they may be able to get some, but it's going to be more and more expensive, and that is just going to mean that there's a little bit more uptime for this Ursa to get a little bit more farm, something like a Basher on top of this Sheepstick that Extremists won't be able to race anymore, because once Ursa blinks in, you could Sheep one, Abyssal another. Should very easily be able to clean out the hero like Lycan or Phantom Lancer before his buildings actually go down. So Extremists, that is going to be a rough fight for them, but they're still possibly going to have enough in the tank just to go for this a handful more times. Like, two or three more successes can win them the game, two or three failures, and they're completely locked out of the game. So it's still a very vulnerable spot for them to be in. They'll just constantly spam in these illusions from the Phantom Lancer, who still has the cheese, by the way. I think he got, like, stunned by the time he wanted to use it or something like that. I'm not really sure what happened in his duel versus the Ursa, but Execration will hold strong towards top. Wolves being really sneaky. Are they actually going to kill this?
Oh my god.
Here we go, Wolves! I believe! Okay, well, the Lancer illusions. There we go. Easy objectives.
Oh geez, this is just going to get so and so hard for Execration. You pointed this out before, but it just gets worse and worse as more Raxes drop. The lack of wave clear is hurting them so much. Now, the only hero that can effectively wave clear is Abed on the Invoker. Actually going to try and go in for a bit of a jump here onto two. They catch up the Enchantress as well as the Doom, already dead and with no buyback on one of them. They get the Doom to actually come back into the fight. Sticky getting stunned up by the Supernova, punched up as well. Very low, he's going to die. That's no buyback on the Lycan. And H-Guard's going to try and go back into the fight, but the pushback from our Invoker, he's almost going to die. The Tornado is going to finish him off as well. That jump from Execration catching Extremis completely off guard. Doom didn't even have a chance to come back in the fray, but what's happening? Is Execration able to slowly chip their way back into this game? This is going to be a very difficult high ground push if that's going to be the result of every fight from now on.
It's this initiation from Execration. Like, when Execration were losing the fights, they were getting blink doomed, or they were just getting doomed. And now, like, the Doom came in onto Abed, pretty much the right target, but the Phoenix initiation was there with the Ursa. That was a flyby Icarus Dive over three heroes with Fire Spirits and Shiva's Guard onto three into a Supernova that's just impossible to crack there for Extremists. There's no way to actually respond to that unless you get the jump onto the Ursa beforehand. And Mad's gonna get rolled over by a boulder. Yes! 100-0 straight from the Invoker. They're gonna swap back the Witch Doctor. Poor guy, not gonna stand a chance in hell. And now the Rakdos are actually dying for Execration's favor. Phantom Lancer's gonna be up in 70 seconds, has a buyback, but this is gonna be probably two sets of Rakdos for Execration, tying up the Rax score now. Late game Invoker with initiation to back it up, and Extremists running out of gas, expending buybacks kind of willy-nilly on the Doom now twice now. He's bought back for very little. Execration will be driven away, fearing the Phantom Lancer, but clearly this fight is not over. Execration, even two Rakdos down, putting up a hell of a good set of engagements, and Ursa has 5,300 gold. Do you have anything on the courier? This is for Tim's, that's not his. Lincoln Sphere, though, is up on the Phoenix. If Ursa is able to get a Basher with buyback backup, it's going to be so difficult for Extremists to take a straight-up objective without doing something cheesy and split-pushy first.
Oh, gosh. This is... This actually, do you think this, how close do you think this game is? Is it actually starting to equalize now?
I would say it's probably like 60-40 in favor of Execration.
You really think so?
Yeah. I don't really give that much credit to these two sets of Raxes because the last set is the one that matters, and in order to get that, you can't really rat it out. You have to go in and just go in straight, and Execration will end that every single time, I want to say.
I kind of want to argue, though, that the split push from Extremis is, it's reasonably good. I actually think they can outright Execration, assuming that they do fall back to the Alliance style of play where they avoid as many fights as possible, keep the creep wave on Execration's side of the map, and once they do manage to draw attention into a fight, use it as a distraction while someone is going to continue on with the split push. But Lycan, as well as the PL, can push very, very quickly. Obviously, Lycan pushes quicker, but I definitely think they can outright Execration, because for Execration, if there's no creeps when they're starting to push, then there's no push. That's it. Like, Execration need the creep wave to be with them. They just can't, they can't outpush anything. They'll take the Roche, it seems, but look at Extremis, they're poised, they're ready.
Doom onto Nando, no BKB, no Sheepstick. He's getting bashed up by Ursa as well, but the Supernova is in the perfect spot with the double Meteor Deafening Blast from Abed as well, doing so much damage to these supports. They will kill off QZ in the pit. They lose the Enchantress as well, and the Ursa is still standing even after Doom. Can he actually lifesteal off of Roshan and get back in there with Aegis? They're going to kill off the Witch Doctor with a handful of supports, and Abed is driving everyone else away. Triple kill for the Refresher Orb Invoker, now looking for four. He's right on top of Sikki. Does he have a Cold Snap? Does he have anything useful, actually? Not much, but now he has the Cold Snap. He's probably gonna regret blinking in so close to the Lycan, but now the Cold Snap is cast with the Forge Spirits minus armor. Abed with the Alacrity 360 Deafening Blast is gonna claim four kills. Lycan actually steals it, never mind, but Ursa lives, grabs the Aegis, travels right back in. Buyback is only up on the Lancer, and this game might just be over. No one else in Extremis can actually join this fight, and Execration can just go straight for the jugular. Phantom Lancer is going to try to backdoor his way to victory, but he's racing up against actually everyone. In a base race scenario, H-God is going to face up against Fortification. The towers will fall for the Radiance. The towers will fall for the Dire, but RR, Kimmo, they're ready to defend. They don't really have to do that much except for stall for the for their allies, who are going to clear off the Ancient beforehand. 360 Deafening Blast to push back the Enchantress, and the Ancient of the Radiant will fall first. Execration are going to claim victory in this nail-biting game one.
Execration, oh geez, I did not expect them to take this series. I thought Extremis had them stuck in their base, had them cowering in their boots, sticking, just thinking that they were going to lose the game at some point, but they stuck around, they get kills, and at some point, as you mentioned earlier, Extremis throwing bodies away to take Raxes, it starts to cost a lot, and it cost quite a bit. It cost Extremis' lead. And I can't help but feel like Extremis getting a little too trigger happy with trying to jump into a team fight against Execration. We saw what happened in the previous team fight. It's a very low chance of it ever being a different outcome just because of the nature of Execration's draft. So for Extremis, if they fell back to the Alliance play, yes, you can give the Aegis away, yes, you can give the cheese away, but consistently split push, I think they would have had a better chance in this series. But what's done is done. It's going to be a win for Execration in the first game of this best of two series. They are both accumulating points, so this is not a best of three, folks. Don't get too excited, but it's still going to be Dota.
Oh, yeah. One more game for right now. It's going to be coming up soon. Just saying, late game Phoenix is legit, whether he's support or offlane. Still going to be doing some very heavy lifting, and Invoker with Fresh Orb Octarine. Same exact thing. Guys, I'm Mike Lars. I've been joined by Danley Cass on the mic. Got Corrupt Drop Bear giving you all the stats, and we'll all be right back for game two between Extremis and Execration.